Hi and welcome to another video. Today I want to talk about GPU overclocking, as you maybe already can see in the background. Yeah, I made some nice plots and I want to explain MSI Afterburner to you, which is our tool to overclock our GPU. Unfortunately, as you can see, there's some controls grayed out in MSI Afterburner, and that's because we are using a vBIOS, which is locked for notebook use. So NVIDIA does not allow mobile GPUs to be unlocked. So, well, normally on the desktop GPUs, you can adjust many of these sliders. So for example, the power limit is a very popular one. Also the temp limit and usually this fan speed. Okay, to begin with, this tool is divided for us in only very small sections. So we got the core clock, you can adjust it here with a simple slider, and the memory clock, easy as that. You can reset the settings and you can apply them, and then the overclock is live. So for example, I go with 212 megahertz. You can see it just changed those two sliders, but the overclock is not active yet because there's no load on the GPU. Which is another interesting feature is to save some profiles in here, like I did. There's some profiles I already tried out. And of course, there's another button which you can activate. And when you activate this one, then the settings would be applied after Windows reboot. So the first things I want to talk about is the core clock. You can see it's at zero at the moment. And you got a little button here, a triangular one. When you press it, then a new window is coming up. It's the voltage frequency curve editor. In this editor, you got some shortcuts. You can essentially do the same as with the slider, but you can also do some more things. So when I hold the Alt key, alternative, I guess, it's the correct name for, and grab one of those points, I can simply slide the whole graph, whole curve upwards. So we can go for 200 megahertz plus, for example. This is essentially the same as this slider would do. Another very useful thing we can do is, let me grab that here, is to use the control key. So you can, for example, tilt this curve upwards at one point. Unfortunately, it's not possible to do that in the middle somewhere, and it's just available for the outer points. And there's also the possibility to mark some areas. You hold on shift key for that, and then you can simply drag those up and down. You can also use the arrow keys to shift a portion of the curve up and down. And there's more useful controls. I will blend them in here so you can use them later if you want. But before we do any overclocking with this tool, I will show you a little plot here. It's from TimeSpy. It's not made by TimeSpy, but I recorded the data using MSI Afterburner and plotted it with the script. And here you can see the frame rate we achieve with this dock settings. So I will show you a lot of plots during this video. So I want to make sure you understand what you see. So this is a plot over time. Sensor readouts does not mean seconds in this case. It's two readouts per second. So the 200 mark is 100 seconds. And you can see the frame rate. Keep an eye on this bar on the left side. So the y-axis, you can always see what is shown here in this graph. The x-axis will be always the same. It's sensor readouts, basically, or seconds or whatever. Yeah, and the first part of the graph, you can see the first scene of the TimeSpy benchmark. Then there's the loading screen here, and then the second part, loading screen again, and the CPU intense part. So we are basically interested almost in the first and second one, because the CPU intensive scene does not use the GPU at all and is not relevant to this video. And this is our baseline score. It's not a very high one, to be honest. Normally you would get a 7800 graphics score. Don't look at the total score, by the way. My CPU score is affecting this one very much. So we are just interested in the graphics score today. So normally you would get 7800. This is lower because my fan settings are very low. It's not full blast like in the stock settings. And also I'm recording the data while running the benchmark, which is always leading to a lower score. So when I would not record anything, I would end up with 7800. Okay, the first thing I want to talk about is the clock overclocking. So which is basically this functionality here. For the first test, I applied 204 megahertz, which is for my GPU pretty much the edge of stability. I can, in theory, go to 220, but this is leading to rare crashes, especially in games. What you see here is that we, when we apply that, we shift upwards the whole curve, as I explained earlier, and you can see that, for example, for 800 millivolts down here, voltage millivolts, the clock requested from the GPU will be higher than before. We see basically a 204 megahertz plus at this point, but trust me, you will not get 204 megahertz plus, because there's a thing that an increased clock frequency does lead to more power loss, because transistors are not perfect. Transistors are those little switches built in billions in our graphic chips or CPUs even, basically any chip. And when you request more switches per second, which is an increased clock speed, of course, then there's also more power consumption. So you will lose more power when you increase the clock speed easily. So that hits the power limit earlier, and therefore you get roughly more like 130 to 150 megahertz. And that's what we can see here too. So let's start with this plot. The gray line is always the stock one, the stock settings. So basically we got 115 watt power limit, 11 gigahertz effective memory speed. So this is a bit confusing. Yeah, I will blend in some data about effective and real, and too complicated to explain it now. And we used the default GPU speed. The orange line, on the other hand, got 204 megahertz GPU core speed plus. We applied via MSI Afterburner, and you can see the frame rate increased quite a lot. Maybe not that much as you may expect it, because I know some people expect, I increased it slider by 600 or so, and then I got like 2080 performance. That's not working like that. We are very limited to the power draw, for example, and of course it's very dependent on your GPU itself. So when you got a good silicon quality, maybe you can do 250. When you got a bad sample, you can only do 150, for example. So as you can see here, it's 204 megahertz, basically 200, let's say. And you can see we got a nice little bump from 46 at this point to more like 48, 49. Then we got a bump up by 6.5%. Pretty much the same story. You can see that in a core clock, as I mentioned earlier, it's not 200 megahertz plus in reality. It's more like 130-ish in this range. The GPU power is the same as stock one, because you know we are limited by the BIOS 215 watts, so nothing changed there. And of course the GPU temperature does not change too, because we draw out the same power from the GPU core. Yeah, and this is our baseline again compared to the 200 megahertz plus we achieved with simply using this little stupid slider, and yeah, you're done. One hint before you just quit this video and pump up that slider to the max. I can tell you that this setting is only stable for me in benchmarks like TimeSpy, but it's not stable in, for example, Witcher 3 or in PlayerUnknown's Battlegrounds, for example. Because those games, and even Shadow of the Tomb Raider, by the way, And that's because those games request way more core clock than time spiders. So when we go back to core clock, you are more on the range from 1800 to 1600 megahertz. So, but real games can use from 1800, 1900, maybe even 2000 megahertz. PUBG, for example, PlayerUnknown's Battlegrounds, it's using a very high core clock. But how we can prevent those crashes, I will show you later. First, we have to take a look into memory overclocking only, because, well, we looked at core overclocking, but not into memory overclocking. So what you can see here is the stock one again in gray, and the dark blue one is effectively less memory speed, and the brighter ones are higher speed. I got to 13 gigahertz effective memory speed, for example. And as you can see here, this also gives us some effect on the frames per second. So as expected, a lower memory clock does get us lower speed, of course. And the higher ones, well, yeah, you can see some kind of fall off. So I would guess that this darker light blue, oh, those color description is great. but I can show you that when we use this 13 gigahertz overclock, which is plus 1000, by the way, in this case, I can show you that you also lose some core clock. And that's because when you simply, as I explained earlier, when you bump up the frequency on anything which contains transistors, it uses more power. So our video memory is drawing more power now, and it's eating that from our power limit. So you can see the 150 watts is still the same, and but the temperature of the core changes, which is supporting that theory. So the white line leads to more power consumption on the VRAM. So the GPU core, the silicon chip itself, is running cooler because it's drawing less power. But we can see a very nice speed bump using the memory overclocking too. So this is our baseline again, and this is our memory plus 500 score, which is basically 120-ish higher. And this is our plus 1000, so this is again maybe 90 higher. So you can see we already gained some speed. So when we combine those two now, so we got core clock improvements and memory speed improvements, then you can see that there's some more headroom. So all those orange bars got 200 megahertz GPU speed plus, and the others represent the memory speed plus. So you can see already that the core clock alone gave us a lot of improvement, and the speed of the memory does improve things even more. But the difference is not that much, that great. And you can see the disadvantage of using higher memory clocks in our core clock graph here. So you can see when we use higher memory overclocks, which is the red line, then you can see that the higher our memory clock is, the lower our core clock gets, of course, as before, just as shown before. The GPU power is the same, as is the GPU temperature. It's pretty much in measuring error range. And again, let's compare to our baseline. Baseline is 7700. And our best score range from 8316 to 8381. So nearly 8400 megahertz. And the desktop RTX 2070, by the way, scores 9300, by the way. So we are just roughly 900 points short on the desktop variant, which is mainly because the desktop graphics card got a 175 watt power limit, and we only got 115 watt.